Hi everyone, welcome to our second lecture on implementing lists, stacks, queues, and priority queues. So last lab, if you remember, one of the assignments was to implement other methods for linked lists, which were missing from the lecture notes. Today I will actually start the lecture with implementing these methods. I will implement contains in two different ways, then get an element at a given index, index of last index of set, and so on. So let's get to the lecture. So there are two different ways that the contains method can be implemented for linked lists. The first way is to basically define a current element, which initially is initialized with the head. Then while the current is different than null, if the current dot element, the data field element of the current node, is equals with the element E, then we return true. Otherwise we continue, current will be assigned current.next, and in this while loop we'll visit all of the elements up to the last element, which basically will have the next, the tail has the next as null. And then we return false if the element was not found. Another way to actually write this is to iterate over the size of our linked list. So we iterate with the for loop over all the elements from I equals zero to the size. And then this is an index. And then with the current still, because this is easier with in a linked list to be initialized with the head. If the current dot element dot equals E, the element that we passed as a parameter, then we return true. Otherwise, we continue by assigning to current next and incrementing I with one. Another version is instead of checking that we reached the null element, do a while loop and check that the current is not equal with the tail. In that case, basically you go up to the last element. And that's the way that you would implement it for a circular list, which we'll talk about, a linked list, which we'll talk about in a couple of minutes. So these are two different implementations for contains. Then get. Get gets an index. We had an O of one time complexity for array lists because they would represent the elements as elements in an array. But for a linked list, we actually have to start with a counter equal with zero and iterate over the elements. So first I have actually a condition. If the size of our array linked list is less than equal with the index, because the index starts from zero, we will basically return null because there is no such element in our linked list. Otherwise, we would initialize a variable with I, an integer variable I with zero. The current element is assigned to the head of the list. And again, in a for loop from zero to that index that we are looking for, we basically assign to the current.next. The moment that the I is not less than the index, strictly less than the index, that basically means that we can retrieve the element. And in that case, we return current.element, and that would return the element of the type E that we want from the get method. Next, we have index of an element E and also last index of an element E. So in the index of an element E, again, we assign the current, the head of the list. We start with the counter I equals zero in a while loop that checks that the current is not different than null. We didn't reach the end. If the current dot element dot equals the element E, we return the index I. If it was not the element that we were looking for, we increment the counter and we assign to current.next. So basically we go to the next element with incrementing the counter and we check again if that is the element that we are looking for. If we couldn't find the element in our list, then we return minus one as the index of the element E that we couldn't find. There was no match. Second method is last index of. So in this case, we can't return from the while loop because we don't know which one is the last element until we reach the end of the list. So in this method, we basically start with current is equal with the head. I is the index that will the variable that we use for basically incrementing the index. And last index is assigned minus one. While the current is different than null, if the current dot element dot equals the element e, the last index is assigned I. And we increment, no matter what, we continue, we increment I with one and the current is assigned current dot next. So this while loop will go over all of the elements in the linked list by assigning to every element that is equal with e, the variable I to the last index. The last variable that will be assigned will be the last index of that element e. So this will also return the last index after the entire while loop iterates over all of the elements. So that will be the last index of an element. Again, everything is zero based. Another method that you have to implement in the lab last lab was if the index is the set method. Given an index and an element e, we would want to set the element at that index if it exists in the linked list to the element e. So in this case, if the index is greater than equal with the size, that basically means that it's outside the range of elements in the array, then we return null. Otherwise, the node e is the current node is the node of elements e is current is assigned with the head, the variable I is assigned to zero. And again, we have a for loop that iterates over the elements up to that index with incrementing the counter. Actually, this increment the counter is not necessary. It basically, we just want to jump over all of the elements prior to the one with the index that we are looking for. Now, because we need to return the element at that index, first we assign to a variable old of the type e, the current element, then the current element is assigned e and we return old. One thing that you notice here is that I don't need to actually deal if it's the tail or not, because we keep the same node, we just change the element in that node to the element e. So another way to actually have to do this was to actually replace the entire node in that location, and then we basically have to redo the links for the elements that are basically referencing that element, but the variables that are referencing that element. But because we only change the element data field, we can leave the same node as it was before. So this is a good implementation of a set. We already covered the iterator last time, and we covered an example of a linked list that is using all of those methods. So just to summarize the time complexities, and in this case, I'm really talking about the worst time complexity for array list and linked list, is the following. The add method has the same complexity. Adding an element will add it at the end. So this is actually something that we discussed before when we talked about the midterm, that adding at the end has the same complexity. And in this case, it's really because linked lists have that tail reference. So we can use the tail reference to go to the last element, and then for tail.next is equal with a new node that gets inserted, and tail is assigned the reference of that new node. So tail will be assigned tail.next. Now, adding an element at a random index in both cases would have, in the worst case, complexity, linear complexity. And the reason, the real reason here is that if it's inserted at the beginning, we basically have to shift the entire array list. For a linked list, if it's added at the beginning, then it's actually just O of one, but adding at a random index is not true because we will have to iterate to that index. And in the worst case is the index of the last element. So we would have to, or the index of the previous to the last element, because we could still add in time of one for in the last element. So in average, basically the worst time complexity is still O of n in both cases for a random index. Clear would take off one. For array lists, we would basically just set the size to zero or create a new array list. For linked lists, we would just assign the head and the tail to null. And then basically we have an empty list and all of the other nodes will be garbage collected. Contains an element E would require in both cases to iterate over the elements. So it would have a linear cost. We would have to compare the element E with every element of the array in the array list. And we would have to iterate with the next link for every element in a linked list to iterate over all elements to compare them with the element E. Get has a better complexity in array lists than in linked lists. For array lists, we can actually get an access to an element of an array in linear time. We just have to add the index or the index of the array multiplied with the size of an element plus the reference that is at the beginning of that array to get the reference for any element in the array. For a linked list, we would basically have to iterate over all elements with the for loop to get the index, to get the element at a random index. Index of an element in both cases, again, would take n steps. It's basically the same with contains. So both methods are, this one returns a true or Boolean literal true or false. Index returns actually the index. Is empty, it's done in constant time because in both cases we have the variable size, which is in the abstract list, my abstract list, abstract class, which is implemented, extended by both subclasses. Last index of would take linear time in both cases because we would have to compare the elements with the last element. We get a better average time complexity for an array list n divided by 2, but it's still O of n. While in the case of a linked list, we would have to go to the end to actually find the last index of that element. So for array list, we can start for the end from the end because we basically have the index and a constant method to get the element at any index. Remove would take n for both cases because we have to find the element. So it's similar to index of. Size just returns the variable size. It doesn't have to measure anything. Remove an element at a given index would be in linear time in both cases because we have to find the element in linear search. That index, and because we have to shift the elements in array list. Set is one of the methods that again array lists do better than linked lists. So for array lists, setting an element at any index has a constant time because we just have to change that element at that given index. We can access the element in linear time and we can assign a different value to it. For linked lists, we have to iterate through the entire linked list to find the index. At first is better for linked lists. We would only have to create a node and point the next reference to the old head and reset the head to the current node. For an array list, we would have to shift the entire array right with one position so we can insert the element that we want to add at the beginning. Similarly, for remove first, we would have to shift all the array left with one position. And for linked list, we only have to, the head is equal with a head dot next. And that's basically an assignment. Any questions? Okay, good. Now, you may have seen many different linked lists, and actually in the assignment today, you have to implement a linked circular linked list. It's a very useful assignment because basically you have to take care of additional pointers, references. So in this case, basically some of the methods have to be changed between simple linked lists and circular linked lists. A circular linked list is a single linked list with the exception that the pointer of the last node, the next pointer of the last node, points back to the first node. So basically, we can get from the last node to the first node within one step. So to just show you one method, for instance, add first. We want to find to add an element at the beginning. What does it change from the original add first method? So most of the lines here of code are similar. Basically, we create a new node for the element E. The new node.next is assigned a head. Basically, the head becomes the new node. The size is incremented with one. If the tail was equal with null, then the tail is assigned to the head. The only difference is the circularity of the linked list, basically of the circular linked list. The tail.next is assigned a head. So basically, before we had the tail.next pointing to the previous head, now we would have to repoint it to the new head that was added. So this is really the line that was created as new, that was not present before. Okay. Another type of linked lists are double. Any questions? Good. Double linked lists. Double linked lists contain two pointers. One points to the next node, and another one points to the previous node. So the advantage is that you can basically, from any node, you can even go to the pair to the previous node. So one method that will be changed and has a better complexity for double linked lists is removing a node from the end. Because before, in order to remove a node at the end, we would have to traverse the entire list previous to the node that we remove. And then we would basically remove that node and make it the new tail. Now we can remove a node from the end by just doing a constant operation. We would use the tail.previous to go to the previous node. We would set that one to be the tail. We would set its next to be null. And then the last node is basically removed. So you need this kind of backward pointer as opposed to a single forward pointer to iterate in ascending order to the elements. So again, how do we change one of the methods? So I took this method for adding first, which we actually had in the previous example. And I changed it such that basically we can now add for double linked lists. So again, much of the code is similar. We create a new node that is with the element E. The new node.next is the old head. The head is now the new node. Now we need to do that link that basically goes from the previous node, previous, back to the head. So I added this interesting statement that I basically use actually the head reference. I go to the next node and I set its previous reference back to the head. So even if that previous was not, was before basically pointing to the tail, now it will be pointing back to the head. Now we increment the size with one and we set the tail to basically null. If it was the tail was null, to set it the same with the head. So this is basically an idea of how to do the implementation of double linked lists. I just noticed one thing and I have to think about it. What to do if basically now we set the next.previous to be the head. So what happens if there were no elements in the list? So next will be null, then head.next.previous will not exist because it was null before. So we actually have to put this in a different place. So the best way to think that this will work is an else branch, which basically only if it was not the case that the previous list was empty, And now we have a head and a tail that are the same node, because in that case, a double linked list will have both null, the previous and the next. Only in the case that it was not the case, that was not the case, the second element should point back to previous reference, should point back to the head. So this is a change that I will save and actually repost on the website, so you can actually use it in the lab today. Any questions? If you see any issues with the programs that I've wrote, please let me know, so basically we can test them together. Next, a circular double linked list. So a double linked list, as we saw, has the two references, next and previous. A circular such a double linked list basically has a next pointer of the tail pointing back to the head. It's circular, basically you can go in a cycle. And a next pointer for, and the previous pointer for the head pointing to the node in the tail. So basically this is a circular double linked list. And again, I took the same method, adding first, and I modified it for circular double linked list. So now there is no problem with setting this, setting the fact that the head next previous is assigned the head, because that basically will assign the previous to itself in the case that the previous link was, the previous list was empty, and the new list is now, the head and the tail are the same element, but next will point back to itself, previous will point back to itself. So now we can basically see that if the tail was previously null, then the tail, it will be equal with the head, and the tail.next is equal with the head, no matter if it was null or not, because those two references will basically be the same. So in this case, we basically do have this line. In either case, we don't have to put it in a different spot. And we do have the fact that we maintain the next link. One thing that I actually see here is not only this, but the head previous should be assigned the tail. That will basically maintain both that next of the tail points to the head and previous of the head points to the tail. So these are actually two statements that will need to be added in our program. Okay. Any questions?
Do you need to do the same thing there that you had done with the previous doubly linked list to move the head.next.previous into an else loop?
I already have that.
Oh, okay.
And the next is already there. So these two statements already do the, because in this case, it doesn't have to be in an else branch, because this will always have to happen, no matter if it's a single element or not. So this is fine. This is the same with the previous case, but it's not done at the end because we don't have to do it at the end. Even if it was null before, there's not a problem anymore. Actually, if it was null before, the same problem arises because head.next is null. So you are right. We still need to do that. Excellent point. Because we can't do this if the previous head was null. So I believe we need to do this. Head.next is equal with a head, that this is the previous head. So I believe now it's correct, but we should test. I mean, it's actually part of the lab today to test it, to do the double linked list. Not a circular one, but a double linked list is part of the lab today. So I would say that try to do it. In fact, in the Java collection framework, there is a sequential list class in java.util, abstract sequential list class, which you can implement too. So you basically implement the Java collections version of a double linked list. So I think it's correct. If you find it that is not correct today during the lab, please let me know. Okay, so what exactly are there better complexities for any other of the previous methods? And the answer is that no, basically for double linked list, you have the same time to add an element of one, add an element at a given index because you need to find that element. Clearing will still be O of one, contains will still be O of n because you need to iterate over all the elements. Index of still is O of one. Again, you need to iterate over all of the elements. Get at an element at an index could be improved because not much, it's still O of n, but you can start from the end instead of starting from the beginning if it's closer to the end than to the beginning. So you would get an average time complexity that is better than n divided by 2. It would be n divided by 4, but it's still in O of n. So growth rate wise, it still doubles when you double the list. Index of still has O of n, as I said. It can be improved a little bit because you can come from the end instead of from the, actually, no, it cannot be improved. It's still the same, because you have to iterate over the entire array. Is empty is still O of one. Last index of is O of n, because you have to iterate over all of the elements, but you can start from the end. So it's a little bit improved in average case, but not in worst case complexity. Remove would remove an element at index at e, and that again it's like contains and get, you need to iterate over the elements. Size O of one, remove at any index would be O of n. Set, add first, remove first are basically O of one. Set is O of n. You get better complexity for remove last, because for double linked list, you can go to the previous element to the tail, and then you would get O of one for remove last, as opposed to O of n that we had for linked lists. So let me actually specify here better complexity O of one for remove last for double linked list, as opposed to O of n for linked list. So not much improvement. That's why I don't get into more details. Okay, so there are three other types that we covered in the Java collection frameworks that we didn't cover for lists. Stacks. So a stack, as you remember, you can only put an element at the top. So you can push an element to the top of the stack, and you can take elements from the top of the stack. So last in will be the first that will be removed. Previous in will be the next one to be removed, and so on. So it's last in, first out procedure. Similarly, queues are basically a data structure where the last element that is inserted in the tail of the queue. And when you get elements, you would get them from the head of the queue. So you need some data structures that basically have good insert at the end, remove from the beginning. So you can always look at the time complexities that we had here for array lists versus linked list, and ask yourself, what is a good data structure for a stack in which I add elements at the end and I remove elements from the end? And as you can basically see, adding elements at the end and removing elements at the end would basically are basically the same between linked lists and array lists. Actually, that's not quite true. Adding elements at the beginning would be O of n, I don't see adding first right here. So of n adding at the beginning and removing at the end, which is just the remove method that we have here, it's better for linked lists. So a queue, a stack is better implemented with a linked list, and a queue is at first remove. So a stack would be better implemented in both cases. It seems that linked lists are are better implementations, although removing at the end is O of N for linked lists. So basically what we can use for stacks are array lists, because insertion and deletion operations are made at only one end, of the stack. And using an array list to implement the stack is more efficient. And using a linked list for a queue is you get better efficiency for linked lists, since deletion are made at the beginning of the list and you get O of one complexity, and you can add at the end of the list, again, you can get O of one complexity in the worst case complexity. So basically you need to implement stacks with array lists and queues with linked lists. There are two ways to implement stacks and queues. One is to use inheritance, like we did for all of the classes that we had in the Java collection framework. Basically, the generic stack would be a subclass of ArrayList, and the generic queue would be a subclass of linked list. Or we can use composition. That means that ArrayList, a generic stack and generic queue are basically classes in of themselves, subclasses of object. And they use an internal array list or an internal linked list to implement the two data structures. Composition is better. Basically, both designs are fine, but composition is better because you can define a complete new stack and queue without inheriting all the unnecessary methods from array list and linked list. You only implement for a stack, for instance, push and pop. You don't need to implement other methods. And also you inherit all the public methods. You don't want to now hide them. So we'll start with the two implementations. A generic stack basically it's implemented with generic programming. You get the two standard to specify the type of the elements. And internally is using a private array list to implement the elements. I could have used my array list, the implementation that we did in our lecture, in the last two lectures, but basically you can use just array list, java.util.arraylist. And then we have the generic methods, the standard methods for stacks. Generic stack to create an empty stack, get the size, which returns the size of the array list. Peak that returns the last element, the element on the top of the stack without removing it. Pop, which returns the element and also removes it from the stack. Push that pushes a new element on the top of the stack and is empty, that returns true if the stack is empty, the size is zero. Generic queue implements, again, uses a private linked list to implement the queue, and it uses enqueue for adding an element at the beginning of the queue and dequeue to remove an element at the end of the queue. So basically first in, first out, and get size, which returns the elements, the number of elements in the queue. So the first one, the stack implementation, is basically quite simple. We actually, one thing that I want to show you is actually the implementation and a small experiment. So let me start Eclipse meanwhile. So the stack basically has the peak method, the push method, and the pop method. The push method is the most important. It adds an element at the end of the array list. So basically the time is in the worst case, linear, but in most cases, it's going to be basically just constant time to add an element. Only when we have to, when we get the size of the list, we'll have to double it. So average time complexity is constant. The worst time complexity is O of N. Pop will do exactly the opposite. Basically, we get the last element of our linked list. The element at index get size minus one, and we also remove the linked list. Now, the truth is that we could get this get method iterates over the array list, so it's not the best implementation. We could basically implement a better implementation would use a way to basically return the last element. So this get for array list is constant, so it just returns the last element. The remove removes the last element, which again is constant time. So is empty returns true if the stack is empty, if the size is zero, and the toString method returns the current state of the stack. So both the add and the push and the pop methods are adding at the end of the stack. So that I should clarify here when we talked about insertion and deletion operations at the end. Of the stack are might actually are only made at the end of the list. So deletion is made at the beginning for a queue, and insertion is made at the end. For queues. Okay. So that's why for queues, we basically have a better implementation if we use a linked list. So again, basically adding at the end in a linked list will give us a unit, a constant time to add an element, and removing an element from the beginning will basically give us again a constant time to remove in a linked list, because we only set the head to the head.next, the next element. Get size returns the size of the entire list, that size variable. And again, it prints the queue with the toString method. It returns a string. So we have two examples in the lecture notes. One that uses stacks, which basically I'm using a stack to push, let's say, the students in a class, Tom, Susan, Kim, Michael, and then print the result of the stack and pop the students in the reverse order as we inserted them. So the first one will be remove Michael, then Kim, and the stack will be Tom and Susan. And the second example of it's of a generic queue in which we enqueue Tom, Susan, Kim, and Michael. And then when we dequeue them, the first one that was enqueued will be removed. So Tom and Susan will be returned first, and then the rest of the queue will be Kim and Michael. And the implementation basically does that. So we have a stack and a queue implemented in the way that I described. And here is the example. First, I have an example of the stack, which basically stacks the objects and then pulls the different examples. And we are left with the original two elements that were pushed in the stack. And then we have the queue, which uses first in, first out mechanism. Okay. Priority queues. So priority queues are regular. So basically regular queues are first in, first out data structures. We append at the end and we remove from the beginning of the queue. In a priority queue, we assign priorities. So the best data structure to actually use for largest in first out behavior is a heap, because we can push the elements, put them always in the heap in logarithmic time, and we can remove the maximum element in also logarithmic time. So priority queues are usually implemented with heaps, and they are used for applications where you need some kind of priority. Like for instance, in an emergency room, the patients have priorities. Basically, you see doctors see a heart attack or an accident patient before patients that cut their finger or smaller, basically, diseases. So the implementation of such a priority queue is basically using the heap data structure that we implemented last week. Basically, a heap is a data structure that we used for, it's a binary, a complete binary tree. It's used, and we actually discussed it for sorting, in which case, basically, every parent is greater than his two children. And adding elements to the heap would add an element at the end of the complete tree, and then swapping it with the parent and continue that swapping until it's greater than both his children. Similarly, a heap, if you want to delete, to get the maximum element of the heap, you would get the head of the heap, then you would replace it with the last element of the heap, and you would exchange it with the largest child, and you continue this process on one of the branches. Both operations are logarithmic, and you can basically implement a priority queue by enqueuing objects in the heap, by adding them to the heap, and dequeuing objects from the heap in the priority queue, and you would always get the maximum by removing the element on the top. And again, I have an example. Let's say that I have multiple patients like John, Jim, Tim, and Cindy with different priorities. John has priority of 2, Jim has priority of 1, Tim has priority of 5, Cindy has priority of 7. And then we basically want to implement our heap. So our priority queue. So we create a my priority queue for patients, which is an empty priority queue. Then we enqueue the different patients with the different priorities, patient 1, 2, 3, and 4. As long as the priority size is greater than 0, we dequeue them one by one. And we will basically get the patients in order of priority. Cindy will be the first one removed. Tim will be the second one dequeued. John, and then Jim, because he had the smaller priority. So now, this is the example. So I implemented heap that we discussed one of the last classes. One other thing that to remember about heaps is that they can be stored in an array very easily. So basically the best data structure that we could use is an array list. You know, every parent has the two children at 2 multiply with the index of the parent plus 1 and plus 2 indices. So the priority queue implementation is this, and the test is quite simple. Now, one change that I request for the lab today is to actually implement the priority queue with a comparator instead of implementing with comparable. So you would have to actually have an explicit constructor that takes a comparator, and then you have to actually use the heap implementation with comparator. So you would have to extend the heap implementation to allow a constructor and also to store a comparator instead of just, again, simple comparable, okay? The implementation of heap you will find in the lecture notes from the previous lecture set, which is basically sorting. And you would have to adapt it for the comparator. Okay. So here we basically have the static class that I'm using for comparing patients. Any questions? Okay. For the last problem of the lab, one thing that you should look look at is my implementation of how do I draw a binary search tree. This is a topic that I will cover next class, but if you want to implement a visualizer for heaps, you would basically have to implement it with some implementation of a tree visualizer in JavaFX or other applications. And I basically have such an implementation with a quite interesting way to display a tree, which basically considers what is the width and the height of the image and how much space you will use for every one of these trees. Remember that a heap which has n elements will have a height of basically log of n. And now if you want to know how many elements are basically in the largest row, that would be 2 to the power of the height, because you basically, you duplicate the number of children at every level. So it will be 2 to the power of log, which is really n. So that will give you an idea how to set the width and the height in the program that you will find in binary search trees to actually visualize a tree in some way. Okay? But I will not get into binary search trees. I think it's good to actually exercise all of these topics today, double linked lists and circular lists if you want to implement, and then priority queues with comparator and modify the heap implementation. And if you want, you can do the last problem of the animating a linked list, but you don't really need to do it if you don't want to. Okay. That's all for today, unless you have some questions. Okay, so there are no questions in the chat. Then I will stop sharing, stop the recording.